She was a darling little girl. She was the daughter of a founder of the Republican Party. She was born to wealth and privilege. She was a member of a family of passionate Quakers who fought against slavery and for universal suffrage. She was the first at practically everything she tried. She was one of the first women to graduate from Cornell University in the 1880s. When she died in 1932, every man, woman, and child in this country was better off, thanks to her fight for decent working conditions. She was turned away from the University of Pennsylvania and Oxford University. Eventually, she received a law degree from Northwestern University and was admitted to the bar before 1900, a rare accomplishment for any woman at that time. She was the first at everything. Passionate and hard-charging, she had guts, and many people, even her children, found her intimidating.
I would imagine she probably wasn't an easy person. She certainly wasn't a gentle person. She was a feisty person.
She was one of the most influential and powerful people of her generation.
She didn't fool around. She didn't backtrack. She didn't use euphemism. She just was very open. And that's, to me, is a very redeeming trait.
She left her mark on so much in our lives that most of us take for granted. She never aligned with any political party, though, like many reformers of the time, she was a socialist.
As a social reformer, Florence Kelley was really an ideal. She faced obstacles both in her life and her work, but she never let them get in the way of accomplishing her goals. She fled an abusive husband. She took her three children with her to Chicago, changing her name and theirs back to her maiden name of Kelley. She had no money when she headed the National Consumers League, but she borrowed from her son Nicholas. He was a successful lawyer in New York. Or she borrowed from philanthropic friends, and she traveled the country, always speaking. She traveled hundreds of days during the year, speaking to women's clubs, speaking to community groups. She talked about children spending their days in dank cellars, baking bread, enduring terrible injuries in mines or in factories. I think of Florence Kelley often in my work for the Consumers League today. And when I face a tough hurdle, I ask myself, what would Florence Kelley do to overcome this obstacle?
She married a Russian-Jewish doctor, Lazar Vishnevetsky, while studying abroad. It was a tumultuous marriage, and when Florence Kelley divorced Lazar, she said in court papers that he beat her. So she fled to New York. Eventually, she took her three children with her to Chicago to live at Hull House, a huge center that sheltered many reformers of the early 20th century. Hull House was started by Jane Addams, whose groundbreaking efforts to improve the lot of poor immigrants in Chicago would become a model for social workers the world over. By the time Kelley arrived at Hull House in 1891, she was already an accomplished public speaker, fundraiser, political organizer, writer. She was fluent in German and translated the writings of the prominent European socialist Frederick Engels. The governor of Illinois appointed her to the post of chief factory inspector, the first female to hold the job, with a staff of 12 hired to enforce the laws. She was born to wealth and privilege and married to a doctor, then became a single working woman with three children to support.
I think everything she did in her life required bravery. She had the backup of, I think, the psychological and monetary backup of her father for a long time. Leaving her husband at the time that she did, leaving abuse at the time that she did, when we know how hard it is today for people to leave an abusive relationship, I think she was incredibly brave. I think it is so hard for people, once they're ensconced in a lifestyle, to break that and go on to something else. It's difficult.
In 1899, she became director of the National Consumers League, a post she held until her death in 1932. The organization's goals were to set a minimum wage for workers, limit the number of hours per workday for women, and remove children from the workplace and get them into school. Among the League's most successful work was the White Label campaign to award a white label to healthful factories and workplaces and to persuade consumers not to buy from employers who didn't earn the white label, employers who ran sweatshops and abused their workers. The landmark case of Mueller versus Oregon, a 1908 Supreme Court decision, was a big victory for women. It limited their workday to 10 hours, 6 days a week. Kelley and Josephine Goldmark persuaded her brother-in-law, Boston lawyer Louis Brandeis, to argue the case before the Supreme Court on behalf of the state of Oregon. In his Mueller brief, Brandeis argued that social evidence, not law, be used to justify the case for limiting the hours women could be forced to work. This first ever Brandeis brief was prepared by Goldmark and Kelley, filled with social evidence about the harm to women from being forced to work 14 or 15 hours a day. The Supreme Court unanimously decided in Brandeis's favor, and it is said that no Supreme Court justice even asked a single question. In 1909, as part of her commitment to equality and fair treatment of all Americans, Kelley, along with other social reformers, helped found the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. She dedicated her life to improving working conditions for women and furiously fought against the exploitation of children. She worked tirelessly to rid urban areas of filthy tenements and sweatshops and to stem outbreaks of diseases such as smallpox that took the lives of so many men, women, and children. When she died in 1932, she was not a household name, but, as Justice Felix Frankfurter said, she had probably the largest single share in shaping the social history of the United States during the first 30 years of this century. Today, the 40-hour work week, the minimum wage, the fact that children don't work in factories and coal mines is largely due to the efforts of Florence Kelley. Her accomplishments live on, improving the lives of working men and women, not just in America, but all over the world.